Honorable Chief Justice of India Designate Justice Kher, Shri Mukul Rohtgi, Attorney General for India, Shri Suri, President of the Supreme Court Bar Association, Shri Sinha, the Vice President, a very, very dynamic Shri Gaurav Bhatia, Honorary Secretary, Shri Ahmadi, former Chief Justice of India, my esteemed brother judges, senior advocates, members of the bar, distinguished guests. For past about 7 years, I must have attended at least 27 or 28 farewell functions from this pandal. But I've never seen a gathering of this size. With so many senior advocates participating. So while sitting there with Justice Kher, I was asking him, look, how many people have gathered to welcome you as Chief Justice of India? I said, what an amazing gathering, what an amazing gathering. The first Chief Justice of India, the first Sikh Chief Justice of India taking oath, and here is this great gathering that has assembled to welcome you. He turned, he said, no, these are not for me, they are for you. I said, why are they here for me? He said, they are celebrating the exit of the terrible Chief Justice of India. And the icing on the cake is that he is now sending me to Bollywood. And if possible, he says, you must re-emerge somewhere in the Rashtrapati Bhavan. I am reminded of what Allama Iqbal said. He said, Ahle ima duniya mein basurate khurshid jeete hain. Khurshid is the sun. Ahle iman jo hote hain, men of faith, they live like the sun. Yahan dube, wahan nikle, wahan dube, yahan nikle. He is right to an extent in the sense that this is the fifth farewell I am getting. And hopefully, for those of you who feel that this terrible man must exit quickly, this should be the final farewell. The first came when I left Jammu and Kashmir for a faraway place in the south, Karnataka. It looked as though I have been exiled by the Chief Justice, who is my greatest benefactor, Justice Venkat Chelya, sent to a place where I knew nobody. I didn't understand the language, I didn't know about the practice of that place, the traditions of that place. But I applied myself. I realized very soon that if you want to build yourself in this career, as you do in the legal profession, you can do it only brick by brick. So, persistent hard work, courtesy and humility perhaps were the first few lessons that I learned as a judge in that court. When I left Bangalore, after about 10.5 years, a satisfied man, a man who didn't want to come back, in fact the transfer policy was reversed within about 3 years of my transfer to Bangalore, and I had the option of returning back to my parent court. I declined. I said, I am very happy here. Bangalore bar had received me so well. The brother judges were so kind and cordial towards me. It was a pleasure working there, and I had got adjusted to my environment. But compulsions at home forced me to return to the north. I was given a farewell by the Bangalore Bar Association. And like the crowd here, the Bangalore Bar Association was also overflowing with the members of the bar. I don't know whether it's a part of my nature or a weakness in me. Parting was emotional, and while I was in tears, even the members of the bar were in tears. Came to Delhi, was received with mixed feelings. A section of the bar, as also the bench, felt that here is a senior man coming over our head. Worked here, but the day I left for Punjab, there was a farewell in the Bar Association, and I still remember the affection and the warmth with which I was given a send-off. I felt vindicated. The farewell from Punjab to Delhi, as my brother Justice Kher described, was still more affectionate. What made it special was that it was not just the bar or the brother judges, but even the employees joined them. And it became a very, very emotional, very, very affectionate send-off which I received. But of all these, I feel the warmth, the affection with which you have assembled here to bid farewell to me surpasses all those farewells that I have received. And for that, I thank you from the bottom of my heart. I also thank the President of the Bar Association, the Secretary Shri Bhatia, the Vice President, the Attorney General, and the Chief Justice Designate for such kind words that they have spoken about me. I started very young. I was just about 20 when I started my career. I remember I knew nothing about any brief which I got in my father's chamber when he got elevated. There were about 4,000 cases, very important matters in the High Court, sessions trials in the trial courts, very, very significant, you see, election petitions in the High Court. The High Court had original jurisdiction, very important suits in the High Court, partition, declaration, and so on. And I knew nothing about any brief. So my chamber works used to start at 5. And I would continue till about midnight in the chamber, and the way the time passed, one wouldn't realize that it is already midnight. It was only after I got married that my wife would remind me it's already midnight, come home, because she wouldn't eat her dinner till I would reach back. At 38, designated as a senior, at 42, elevated. The rest has been a uneventful, placid journey in the judicial hierarchy. But if you ask me, when I look back, I feel the most interesting and the most challenging times that I had in my life were as a struggling lawyer. Preparing a brief, thinking of a point, looking for judgments, arguing before the court, some of them patient, some of them very impatient, used to be a great challenge. Every morning used to be a challenging morning. And I miss those days. I miss my days as a lawyer. And if you ask me, that one amendment that I would like the Constitution to be made of, it is to let the retiring judges free to start practice again. Because most of us are at heart lawyers. You may become judges, but eventually when you introspect, when you reevaluate and reassess yourself, you realize that you are a lawyer at heart. I have seen over the years this race for becoming a judge, efforts to become a judge. And very recently I have seen the race for becoming a senior advocate. I have always felt that these distinctions should come to you uninvited. You should not invite them, you should not ask for them. You must be considered deserving and suitable for such a distinction. But why should a lawyer at all want to become a judge if he is not saturated with his professional career? If you ask me, there are a number of occasions when I felt that this youngster who has so much work, if I had half that much work in the Supreme Court when I wanted to shift from Jammu to Delhi, I would have never become a judge. I would not have liked to become a judge. The difficulty in shifting to Delhi for a youngster is that if you are doing well in your own court, you give up all that to start afresh in the Supreme Court, where you will start from a scratch. You will have to rub shoulders with the eminent people. And if you have Nariman practicing in the Supreme Court, Sundaram practicing in the Supreme Court, and a host of other eminent lawyers practicing in the Supreme Court, you feel you may be inadequate for that job. So shifting from a high court to the Supreme Court is always a very tough decision. And people who are comfortably placed in their own courts are finding it very hard to shift to Delhi, because coming to Delhi and starting a new career here is so much more difficult than to start and succeed in your own court. We have over the years seen people who have risen very high and made a great mark. But those of you, and this is for the younger members of the bar who are always, you see, desirous of excelling, I would only recite Allama Iqbal again, who said, Khudi ko kar buland itna ki har taqdeer se pehle khuda bande se khud puche bata teri raza kya hai. So you ought to rise yourself to a level where destiny itself beckons you to shoulder higher responsibilities. I will beseech, I will request, I will advise my younger friends to apply themselves and not to lose the opportunity that comes their way. I have always mentioned this to youngsters in universities, in bar associations, that lawyers are like performers in a theatre. An artist looks for a beginning, an opening. He wants a break. You must have seen many great actors and actresses always remember the director who gave them a break. They are always looking for a break because they feel they are so much full of talent that they just need a break to prove themselves. Lawyers are also in the same position. You ought to think that what is coming your way in the form of a brief is a great break. And if you do not grab that opportunity and do your best, it may never come again. Opportunity may never knock at your doors again. Nothing pains me more when I see a youngster having a brief, a client having trusted him with his brief, not doing well in the court. Because by not doing well, he loses that client. He loses the respect of his opponent. And he loses his self-respect and his reputation in the eyes of the court also. So each and every brief that you handle, each and every case that you conduct is a challenge. And you cannot afford even a single person to go out of the court and say, this young boy did not do well. He was unprepared. He is not adequate for the job. The performance, if it is good, will earn you a good name, but if it is bad, it will earn you and give you a bad name. And no lawyer can afford even a single detractor, a single critic, a single individual who goes around telling people, there was this man whom I engaged, but he did not do well, he let me down, he was inadequate for the job, he was inefficient or incompetent. If you look at this situation today, I don't have much to say on matters which I have dealt with, decisions that have been handed down, judgments that have been delivered. Those may keep reminding you about me for a long time, because judges who have delivered judgments live even after their natural lifespan. Judges are read. Today we read the judges, or you are in the company of eminent judges who have written great judgments which are published in newspapers and in the law reports. But if you look at your assets, you have a jurisprudence which is time-tested, Anglo-Saxon jurisprudence, common law principles in which equity plays a very important role. You have had very eminent judges in this country, very, very eminent lawyers who have shaped the jurisprudence of this country over the past 70 years or so. You have laid the foundations firm and deep. And these are the signs of great success on which you can build a great edifice. Your present has great challenges. You have the challenges of areas. You have 3 crore cases. You have problems of infrastructure. You have problems of the judge strength being low. You have great challenges in the present. But please remember, you will have greater challenges in the future. And that is what you have to be prepared for. You will have very, very serious issues coming up in times not very far from now. You will have issues regarding cyber laws. You will have challenges of, you see, issues touching medical, medical-legal cases. You will have issues of genetics. You will have issues of privacy. You will have issues of making India an inclusive society. All these issues are very, very grave issues. And as the country is on the cusp of a great resurgence, the country is growing, the country is developing very fast, the country is emerging as a great superpower, not only in terms of armaments, but also in terms of economic power. This country cannot progress unless judiciary also gets ready to handle the challenges that the development and progress bring with them. So my request to the bar and all those who are associated with the judicial system, including my brother judges at all levels, is that you need to get ready for the challenges of the future. Please remember that you do not build bridges. You may not be building projects, hydel projects and other great and very formidable projects. But your role is so critical for building those things that you must make sure that you perform your role. The progress in the form of construction of projects and great development all around is impossible unless there is peace in this society. And that peace is possible only when the administration of justice and the judiciary plays its role to its fullest. I have played my role. I have been a part of this institution in one capacity or the other for past 45 years. I may be retiring from this institution, but I will keep praying for its prestige from outside the sanctum sanctorum of the Supreme Court. I will continue praying for the judiciary to remain fearless and to do all that the common man of this country expects it to be doing. I will continue to be a spectator, an observer, and if possible, a contributor in whatever form I can, because whatever I have today in terms of my name, my respect, it is because of this institution. And I will have no hesitation in paying back to this institution whatever it has given me. Left to me, I sometimes am reminded of what Gali would say, enough is enough. These crowds and these celebrations and these parties and these occasions can be left back, left alone. Go to a place where you can retire in peace, as for instance he says, रहिए वैसी जगह चलकर जहाँ कोई ना हो, हम जुबान कोई ना हो, हम सुखन कोई ना हो, बेदरो दीवार सा एक घर बनाया चाहिए, पासबाँ कोई ना हो, हम साया कोई ना हो, पड़िए जो बीमार तो ना हो कोई तिमारदार, और अगर मर जाइए तो नोहे कहाँ कोई ना हो. बट देन आई हैव सीन दिस with my experience. I have a summer house my father built, one in a place called Batot. I go there sometimes for about a week. You feel you are so comfortable, there is nobody to disturb you. The deodar trees and the chinar trees and the fruit trees provide a perfect, you see, a retreat for you. But after a week you start craving for some coffee in barista in the Khan market, or some association or some intellectual interaction with somebody. So as they say, कभी किसी को मुकम्मल जहाँ नहीं मिलता, कहीं जमीन तो कहीं आसमां नहीं मिलता. So life is a compromise. I think one can be happy only when you draw a moderate kind of a course for yourself, and I'm sure this is going to be helpful to me to somehow tide over my days of separation from this institution with which I have been associated so deeply and so thankfully. I take this opportunity now to express my thanks. First of all, my thanks to God Almighty, who gave me this opportunity to and blessed me to serve the people of this country to the best of my ability. You can rest assured I did the maximum or the best that I could. I thank my parents who nurtured and inspired me to lead a life of rectitude. My teachers who taught me, my colleagues who worked with me in different courts and in different stages of my career, and from whom I learned so much. I'm also thanking the Secretary General, the Registrars of the Supreme Court, who are always ready and willing to do that extra work or the go extra mile for my sake. I thank my personal staff, Shri O.P. Nagpal, Pooja, D.K. Gupta, Fanny Krishna, Gaurav Sharma, my driver Amar Singh, Anil, Manjeet Singh and Rajkumar, my cooks Nandaram and Kishan Chand, my peons Paramjeet, Ranjit, Mohan, Rahul, Pankaj, Chandan Singh, who made me so comfortable. And I also thank the media, who has been always very, very supportive. Rarely have I got the impression that I was misquoted or I was unfairly treated. They have always been very, very objective, and I thank them also for standing by whatever was said in the court or whatever views were expressed. They have been very, very faithful in projecting the observations in the court. And I thank you all for being here, for being so very affectionate and so very kind to me, and for having made my work so easy while I worked in the court, and for your prayers that you have offered for my well-being after my retirement. I'm extremely grateful to you. I know it has been a working day, such a large number of people coming and attending this function, I'm sure, is only because I earned your affection, not because I did anything special for you, but because I did the way I ought to have done, and that much as I ought to have done. Thank you very much, and God bless you all.